Hey guys, it's Liza. Welcome back to another video. I'm sure you can already tell from the title of this one and from the shirt that I'm wearing. It is almost my absolute favorite month of the year. That is right. Inktober is just around the corner. Are you ready for it? Let's get started. So if you're new to this channel and you don't know who I am, hello, my name is Liza Compass and I am an artist making videos about art, music, life, and my creative journey as a whole. So if that's something that you're interested in and you'd like to see more content from me in the future, don't forget to hit that subscribe button down below and join this amazing and growing family. So Inktober was originally started back in 2009 by artist and cartoonist Jake Parker as a way to personally challenge himself to create a new pen and ink drawing every day throughout the month of October. From here, the Inktober tradition was born, and since then it has grown exponentially, exploding on social media every single October with millions of artists participating all over the world. I participated in Inktober for the first time last year in 2019, and I'm proud to say that I actually finished. I did it every day, and I genuinely feel like I grew my skills as an artist. It gave me confidence, and I am so excited to do this again. For those of you who aren't familiar with my story, 2019 was a huge year for me. It was the year I finally broke out of a 5-year-long hiatus I'd taken from creating art altogether. I'd basically thrown in the towel several years ago, and honestly, Inktober had a huge part in bringing me back to the thing that I loved most, creating art and sharing it with you guys. And personally, I feel like that's the most important thing about this entire challenge. It's not about following the rules or creating the most elaborate, jaw-dropping drawing that you can each and every day. It's not about following the prompts, and it's not even about finishing, to be completely honest. It's about letting your creativity flow, encouraging yourself to take the time to create something, to set aside time for your art, to prioritize it, and to put it out into the world. But most importantly, it's about having fun. With that being said, Inktober was originally created with the idea of using traditional inking methods, meaning to create black and white drawings on paper using ink. And that's it. So for the purpose of this video, I'm going to be focusing on traditional inking methods, but keep in mind there are no rules here. You can apply these methods that I'm about to show you to all kinds of different drawing techniques. And let's be real, my drawings last year were absolutely filled with color, even though they were done, mostly, all with ink. I'm going to show you a lot of examples of my work throughout this video, and you'll be able to see exactly what I'm talking about. And you can be sure that my pieces this year are going to be just as colorful, if not more so. Before we dive in, let's look at some of the basic materials you're going to need. Something great about inking is you don't need all of the fancy, expensive stuff to really get started. For this video, I'll be using some of my favorites, including this basic set of fineliner pens, a brush tip pen, some India ink, brushes, and maybe even a dip pen, and that's it. Now, if you want to get more adventurous, go right ahead. There are so many options when it comes to inks and ink-friendly mediums. So pull out your colored inks, your watercolors, your markers, gel pens, and paint. Break as many of the rules as you want, because you're more than welcome to let your creativity run wild and free. But on the other hand, if you don't have all this stuff and you can't go out and buy some new materials, that's completely okay too. Plenty of people create amazing drawings every single year with things like Sharpies, ballpoint pens, highlighters. Really, whatever you have access to is perfectly okay. I don't think Inktober is about the materials you use at all. It's about creating every single day and allowing yourself to grow as an artist. Besides your inking implements, you'll need something to ink on. If you have any drawing paper or are ready to go out and buy some, I would highly recommend looking for papers that are both thick and smooth. These are some of the papers I use on a regular basis for ink drawings. Bristol is designed primarily for markers, which means it's smooth, thick, and designed not to tear as you're loading the paper with pigment over and over and over again.
I also have some tone papers, which are extremely thick and come in a variety of colors, which can be really fun to draw on instead of just plain old white. If you plan on using wet techniques, such as brushing on India ink, watercolor, or anything else that requires you to load the paper with a lot of water, you should really consider using a cotton-based watercolor paper, or at least some sort of mixed media paper. For our drawing today, I'll be using this block of watercolor paper because it's designed to take wet media and not curl up and buckle as it dries. Because this paper is 100% cotton, it is also able to take a lot more punishment from my pens without wearing away, even once it's gotten wet. When buying watercolor paper, you'll notice you have an option between cold press and hot press. The main difference here is that cold press has that textured surface we tend to associate with watercolor paintings, whereas hot press has a smooth surface. Because we're using this paper to draw, I definitely recommend going with hot press because drawing over textured paper with pen can become grainy, difficult to control, and just not a very fun experience. Now that we have all our supplies, let's start talking about mark making. Really, there are countless ways to create dimension, texture, and movement with different mark making patterns and styles. But at the end of the day, most of these techniques can be broken down into just a few basic mark-making methods. And even though all of these marks are going to have a completely different look and feel, they can all be utilized for the same vital purpose, which is to provide a range of values and give dimension to your drawing. This first method is called stippling, which is made up of a series of tiny, tiny little dots. This method is probably by far the most tedious and time-consuming, but it's also one of the best methods to practice if you're still trying to get the hang of creating convincing value transitions. When we talk about value, all it means is how light or dark something appears to be. This transition between values is what gives your drawing three-dimensionality. It's the difference between a 2D drawing that is made up of just only outlines and a drawing that might be more realistic or 3D in appearance. If you're used to drawing in pencil, pastel, or using paints, you're probably used to thinking of value in terms of shading or blending. But when we're using pens, we don't have that option. In this case, I'm applying black pen to white paper. I can't thin out these dots to literally make gray or blend it into the background. Instead, we need to focus on creating the illusion of value transitions with how we place our pen marks. This is why I feel stippling is the best method to practice if you're just getting started. Although it's tedious, it's pretty easy to see that the more densely packed your dots are, the more dark or in shadow the area will appear. And as I move out over the sphere into the midtones and toward the highlight at the top, my dots are becoming further and further apart. So even though my drawing is still just black and white with no gray area in between, it still implies three-dimensionality, which is exactly what we're going for. Next, we're going to do the same thing, but instead of dots, we're going to be using straight parallel lines. This method is called hatching, and while this sphere will have a different visual texture from the stippled example, the principle is still the same. The denser and closer together I make my marks, the darker the area appears, and vice versa. Cross-hatching is extremely similar to hatching. In fact, I like to think of them as cousins. The only difference is now we're crossing lines over one another rather than drawing them all in the same direction. We're going to tackle this next one with a method called contouring. For this technique, your lines should have curve in some way to imply the shape of your object. For our purpose here, this seems simple enough. All we have to do is wrap this sphere in various arcing lines. But this method can be tailored to fit any shape you're trying to give dimension to, like tree limbs, fur, or even faces. The possibilities here are endless, and when used correctly, this method can look very convincing. But if you're wanting an even looser, more organic feel, try going crazy with scribbles. These are great for adding unique visual texture, and also a quickly scribbled look is just plain fun to draw. Giving myself permission to scribble allows me to let my guard down and just have fun. Heck, I've even found my own scribbling style from doing this, which I find creeping back into my art all the time, no matter what medium I'm using. And last but not least, you can ditch your pen for a brush and dip into some classic wet techniques. For this, we'll be using India ink and water to create a subtle ink wash effect. India ink is truly incredible. It is a versatile, water-soluble ink, which when applied straight gives a dark, opaque, and even coverage. But it's also easy to dilute with water and create an array of medium to light gray tones. Painting with ink is similar to watercolor in many ways, but they don't behave exactly the same. Ink tends to dry faster, especially the less diluted it is. So if you're going to try adding water to blend it out directly on your drawing, you need to work fast. It doesn't take long for India ink to settle in and leave harsh edges on your paper. India ink is also attracted to water, so you can control the flow of your ink by wetting an area of your drawing first, and then applying the ink straight into it. I'd recommend getting out a spare piece of paper and just playing around to figure out what you're able to do and control, and what effects you even like and don't like, especially before taking the ink straight to your drawing. India ink is very permanent, so be careful. It will definitely stain things. Using wet India ink is an art form all in its own. It can be both finely controlled and beautifully chaotic, and really, it's all up to your personal taste and style, so have fun. So far, we've learned all about the materials you'll need and gone over 6 different mark-making techniques. Now, we're going to take everything we've just learned and put it all together. After making a light outline in pencil to keep us on track, I'm going to start by filling in the eye with stipples. I've chosen the stippling method because I feel it's going to allow me to build value in a subtle yet controlled way. I don't want the lines and reflections in the eye to be too harsh right at the start. However, I would like the option to give extra definition to the curvature and dramatic reflections that can naturally be seen in the side profile of an eye. I'm going for implied realism, while also allowing my drawing to have a relaxed and dreamy vibe. Basically, I want this kitty to feel both real and otherworldly all at the same time. To do this, I'll focus on certain features like the eye and front of the face to achieve lifelike characteristics, while allowing my drawing to become loose, chaotic, and less defined as it falls back into the cheeks, ears, and shoulders. You'll see more of what I mean by this as we keep going, but for now, it's really important to get the values right in the eye. I'm making the top and bottom creases extremely dark, and then rounding out the values dramatically to give it a shape of undeniable presence. I ultimately want viewers to be drawn into the eye first, so I'm going to spend a good chunk of my time getting it right. This way, I can allow the rest of the drawing to emerge in a way that complements it rather than distracting from it. I am looking at several different photos for reference, some of my own cats and others from random pictures of the internet. I'm not trying to copy any of them exactly, but I am using them as a guide to check proportion, shape, lighting. I'm also using them to check how the fur moves around the cat's face, nose, and whiskers, and basically make sure I'm drawing something that actually is going to look like a cat when I'm done. If you're unsure about combining concepts from multiple references or drawing straight from memory, start by practicing your skills from just a single photo. You can use a picture you've taken or search from tons of royalty-free images online that you can replicate exactly without having to worry about any copyright violations. Moving on throughout the face, I'm using a combination of hatching, cross-hatching, and contouring techniques to build up texture. Through careful contouring, I can control the direction and curvature of where the fur is moving over my cat's face, showing off the arc of its nose, its protruding brow, and the way his fur hangs loosely from around his mouth. Building the textures within the cat's face has me going back and forth between several techniques. From using harsh diagonal lines to fill in the sloping shadow of its nose, to shaping the subtle lift of its cheekbone. As you can see, all of the techniques we've been talking about are coming together to create the whole. We start to forget where one type of mark starts and where another begins, but really, does it even matter? I don't think so. This is one of the reasons I love inking so much. Even though it's an incredibly raw and even harsh medium at times, it provides a unique challenge to see beyond this mere jumble of lines into a greater potential. Something so unique and subtle that it's hard to put your finger on how exactly the artist made it work, but it does. I'm pretty satisfied with how it's looking so far, so now it's time to get a little messy. I have this idea for my cat to look like it's dripping off the page like a pile of ink. So to make that happen, I'm going to go in with India ink and a brush to start layering ink washes, first using the ink to establish the shape and fall of the shoulders, and then adding more ink onto my wet paper, allowing it to spread out organically. Painting with wet ink is the exact opposite of drawing with dry techniques. Whenever I go into this with some kind of plan, the ink always ends up going in its own direction, sometimes quite literally. But that's the beauty of wet ink, the chaos it brings against the otherwise rigid control of pen drawing. It may seem counterintuitive, but the best way to incorporate ink into any drawing is to make a plan and then be perfectly okay with throwing that plan out the window once you get started. Practice being flexible with this and making it work in whatever direction the ink takes you. And honestly, you'll probably be blown away by what you're able to come up with. All right, I know I said I wasn't going to use color, but look, I lied. I just really think the background needs something extra, and also the eyes would look really cool in color too. I'm thinking a combination of bright yellow and green in the background, so for the eye, I'm going to go in with yellow, green, and orange markers. These are alcohol-based markers that I picked up at Blick Art Materials, and they really are a great generic alternative to Copics. These markers are less than half the price, and in my opinion, they work just as well. I am not sponsored, so don't come for me, I'm just saying it like it is. In any case, alcohol markers are great because they easily blend together. Like Copics, these come with both a broad and a brush tip. The broad tip is great for hard edges and filling in large areas, while the brush is good for smaller details and blending. To finish, I'm going to fill in a loose, watery box behind my cat, first with yellow and then gradually building up the area nearest the figure with puddles of green ink. These are acrylic-based inks, meaning that just like our India ink from before, they are water-soluble and pretty much behave the same way. I can control the intensity of the color by using it straight from the bottle for the darkest, most vibrant pops of color, or by adding water to create progressively lighter washes. For some final touches, I'm going to run some lines of white ink over the whiskers and scribble in some facial highlights with my dip pen to give some subtle variation over the black. It still needs a little something extra though, so I'm going to go in with this white gel pen and add some super bright highlights with some extra whiskers and little glints here and there in the fur. I'm also going to add some stars because why not at this point? Adding color to this drawing got my creativity pumping and has pushed it in a fun new direction that I actually really love. And with that, I think this cool little cat is done. This turned into something a lot more interesting than I thought it would be, so I really hope you guys enjoyed following along. I hope this video has been able to demystify ink drawing for you, or at the very least give you a fresh perspective on some techniques that maybe you already use. Drawing does not have to be scary. Inktober is a fun tradition filled with artists who are kind and encouraging with a desire to grow, to learn, and to share their love of art with others. So I really hope you'll join all of us in yet another amazing and magical year of Inktober.
Thank you guys so much for watching. I really hope you enjoyed this video. If you did and you want to see more like this, don't forget to hit that like button down below. Leave me a comment letting me know what you thought of the video. And most importantly, don't forget to hit that subscribe button and join this amazing and growing family. I have so many more surprises coming throughout the entire month of Inktober. So if you don't want to miss them, go ahead and ring that notification bell down below so you'll be updated every single time I post a new video and you won't miss a single thing. Thanks again for watching, guys. I love you all, and I will see you in the next one.